Hello learners, this is the part 2 of ratio analysis. In our part 1, we have explained the liquidity ratio, in which we have taught you, explained you about the current ratio and the quick ratio. Today in part 2, we are going to discuss on the activity or a turnover ratio. As the name suggests, these are the ratios which are based on the activity of the business or on the turnover, which basically means the sales. So these are the ratios which are related or are calculated with the help of the sales cost of goods sold of the business. In this, we are basically going to include four different type of ratios, which are basically the stock turnover ratio, debtors turnover ratio, creditors turnover ratio, and the working capital turnover ratio. In this session, we are going to discuss for all these four different type of ratios in detail. Madam, explain our learners, what do we exactly mean by the term activity ratio?
Okay. Now, the second type of ratios could be the activity ratio, the turnover ratio, or the performance ratio. We all know that the main objective of any business is to make profits, and profits depend upon the rate of turnover. Turnover here means the rate at which the business is deploying its assets. That means, is the business using its resources available in an efficient and effective manner or not? This is what is the main objective of computing the activity or the turnover ratio. So these ratios measure the efficiency and effectiveness with which the firm manages its resources available. Now, under this, the ratios that can be computed to analyze the activity or turnover of the firm can be the stock turnover ratios, the debtors turnover ratio, the creditors turnover ratio, and the working capital turnover ratios.
As we have told, we are going to discuss all these four types of ratios. I would request you to please explain one by one. First of all, we are going to take the stock turnover ratio.
Stock turnover ratio.
So, what we basically have the meaning of it, its significance, its formula, and its standard ratio. Explain it.
Now, the stock turnover ratio, or we also call it as the inventory turnover ratio, this ratio establishes the relationship between the cost of goods sold or the cost of sales and the average stock available. Now, the major purpose of computing these stock or inventory turnover ratio is the number of times the inventory or the stock has been rotated during the accounting period. How many times you have used the stocks or the inventory available, because the profits would be totally dependent on the number of times that you are rotating your inventory.
So someone has started up a business with a sum of rupees 1 lakh. He bought a goods for 1 lakh rupees, sold them in a market, get it cash back, again purchase the goods, again sell it in a market. So here we are simply going to calculate it, that how many times this turnover took place.
How many times this cycle is being rotated.
Okay.
So more is the number of times the rotation, the better would be the profitability. This is what we are trying to judge through these stock or inventory turnover ratios. Now, the formula that can be used to compute these stock or inventory turnover ratio is cost of goods sold upon the average inventory. Now, in comparison to the current ratio and the quick ratio that we discussed, there is no standard ratio to measure, but of course, we say that higher the better. The more is the ratio, the more would be the ratio only when the number of that cycle increases. So, more is the rotation, the better it is for the firm in terms of the profitability. Now, when we say cost of goods sold and average stock are the two components of stock inventory ratio, then what do we mean by these cost of goods sold and inventory? Now, when we are computing the cost of goods sold, this of course is determined through the trading account, through the financial statements. Now, these cost of goods sold can either be determined from the debit side or from the credit side. So, if we determine it from the debit side of the trading account, then it becomes opening stock plus direct expenses plus the purchases, and from that we deduct the closing stock. And similarly, if we compute it through the credit side of the trading account, then it simply becomes the total sales, the total net sales minus your gross profit. So, either of the two will give the same result, value, whether you go by the debit side or you go by the credit side. By average stock, we means the average of the two stock. That means opening stock plus closing stock divided by the two.
Suppose if a question is there where only one stock is given, and that is the closing stock, then how do we calculate the average stock?
then of course we take only the closing stock. In that case, average stock is not required. So it depends upon the information that is available to us to compute the ratio. Whatever is available, we go by that. But the standard format of course is this, but depending upon the availability of the information provided, we proceed further.
Okay. If the opening and closing stock both are given, then we simply add them and divide it by 2.
Absolutely.
That's one way of getting. On the other hand, if only one stock is given, which is basically the closing stock, then that closing stock itself become the average stock. As we have mentioned in our earlier discussion, that ratio can be expressed in different forms. It can be in terms of percentage, it can be in terms of is to, it can be in terms of times and so on. So, what is the basic standard for expressing the stock turnover ratio?
Now, these turnover ratios and especially the stock turnover ratio, we always express it in terms of times,
okay.
pure number form.
So, it could be 4 times, 5 times, 2 times, 1 times. So, whatever be the value comes up, we have to put it in terms of times. And you have mentioned ki higher the ratio, the better is considered
profitability.
Can you explain this thing in a much more better way with the help of an example or some illustration?
Yeah. We'll take an illustration to explain how to compute the stock turnover ratio. Let us say that the total sales for the firm are 4 lakh rupees. Gross profit is 20% of the sales. So, 20% of 4 lakh would be about 80,000. The opening stock is 38,500 and the closing stock is, let us assume to be as 41,500. Now, to compute the stock turnover ratio, it is cost of goods sold upon average stock.
So, cost here I would like to interfere. Just we are going to be take cost of goods sold only, can't we take sales?
Yeah, we can take, again as I said, depending upon the availability of the data, whatever the standard format is, of course, cost of goods sold upon the average stock.
In case if a question says both the things, sales is also given, gross profit is also given, and we are in a position to calculate cost of goods sold. So, are we going to take only cost of goods sold?
Yeah. Appropriate would be that we compute cost of goods sold, but in case let us say only annual sales have been given, the rate of gross profit on sales is not defined to us. In that case, we can just proceed by
proceed on the basis of sales.
Okay. Appropriate would be that we proceed by cost of goods sold, but depending, again I am repeating, depending on the availability of the data, we have to proceed.
Because the stock is always going to be related with the cost and not with the sales. That's why we take the cost of goods sold in a much more appropriate manner.
Proceeding on the same illustration, we have to compute the stock turnover ratio. So, that will be cost of goods sold upon average stock. Now, taking the illustration further, we have to compute the stock turnover ratio, which is cost of goods sold upon average stock. In our illustration, the total sales defined to us are 4 lakh minus the gross profit, which would turn out to be 80,000. So, COGS gives us rupees 3,20,000. Average stock is opening stock and closing stock, and both are defined in the illustration. So, we take the average of these two figures, which turns out to be 40,000. So, the stock turnover ratio becomes 3,20,000 upon 40,000. That means the answer gives us at 8 times. So, during the year, the stock is being rotated 8 times.
Businessman is able to purchase the goods and sold them in the market for 8 times. This is what we means to say. Okay.
Now, apart from this, we can also compute the stock conversion period or inventory conversion period. That means how many days or how many weeks or how many months the stock is converted into cash. That means what is the time frame of this cycle. So, the formula becomes the number of days
in a year.
So, 365, of course, until and unless it is defined in the question that you assume the year to be 360 days or any other, whatever is defined. Or if we take it by weeks, so it becomes 52 weeks, or months, so it becomes 12 months. So, depending upon whether we want the answer in days or weeks or months, we take the numerator as it is and then divide it by the stock turnover ratios, which we have already computed, and that will give us the time frame or the total time period that is required to complete the cycle one time. So, in our example, since the illustration says that the total number of days to be included are 360. So, 360 divided by 8, it gives us 45 days. So, the business is taking exactly 45 days to complete
one cycle. For converting the cash and to the goods into the market in terms of cash.
And of course, the shorter would be the period, the better it is for the business.
Okay. Now, learners, we have came to know exactly the meaning of the stock turnover ratio. which basically include cost of goods sold, and we divide it by the average stock. Cost of goods sold can very easily be calculated by taking the opening stock plus purchases plus all direct expenses minus closing stock. This is one way. On the other hand, you can take net sales minus gross profit. This is the way you are going to calculate cost of goods sold. The way you are going to calculate the average stock is opening stock plus closing stock divided by 2. It's one of the very simple method and very easiest form to calculate the stock turnover ratio. Always your answer is going to come in terms of times. Now, once we have came to know the stock turnover ratio, the other thing comes out to be the debtors turnover ratio. Again, I request you to explain our learners the meaning, the significance, the formula and the standards, if supposed to be there any, for the debtors turnover ratio.
Now, for the debtors turnover ratio also, the objective remains the same. That means we are trying to find out the time frame during which the debtors are converted into cash. Now, what exactly are debtors? Debtors are those from which the business owes money. That means you have sold goods on credit to them and they owe you your money back. So, how much time does it take to convert these debtors into cash? This is what we are trying to analyze by computing the debtors turnover ratio. So, the ratio establishes the relationship between the credit sales, that means the sales that you have made on credit, and accounts receivable, the average accounts receivable. Now, the purpose or the significance of these debtors turnover ratio is to determine the efficiency with which the trade debtors are being managed, that how fast the business is managing its debtors in realizing their cash from these debtors. The formula that we use to compute these debtors turnover ratio is the net credit sales upon the average accounts receivable. Now, accounts receivable would include both the debtors as well as bills receivable. Now, there is no standard or uniform ratio that is to be kept in mind, but again, the higher the ratio, the better it is, and the interpretation for this also remains exactly the same as for the stock turnover ratio.
Here, learners, I would like to quote, when you are going to calculate the net credit sales, be very sure that you are going to take the total sales minus cash sales. If no such kind of information is given, what do we mean by the total sales is total net sales. If there are any sales return, that is also going to be deducted. Suppose in a question, we won't have the cash sales. Then the total sales minus sales return itself is going to become the credit sales. And when you are going to calculate the average account receivable, be very sure that you are going to take the value of opening debtors, closing debtors, opening bill receivable, closing bill receivable divided by 2. All the four things will be added and they are going to be divided by 2. Again, as we have done in case of the stock turnover ratio, at the time of calculating the average stock, suppose if only one value of the debtor and one value of the bill receivable is given, you add both of them but won't divide it by 2 because they itself is an average. Average is going to be taken only when the opening as well as the closing values are given.
Absolutely.
If these two things are given, then you add them divided by 2. If these two things, opening and closing, are not given and only one value is there, then that one value itself is going to become the average. And again, this ratio is going to be expressed in terms of times as we have done in case of the stock turnover ratio. Simply, what you have to do is take the net credit sales of the business divided by the average accounts receivable. I will request the madam to explain it in a much more better way with the help of an example.
Okay. Now, before explaining it through an example, there is another thing which we can make use of this debtors turnover ratio, that is to compute the debt collection period or the average collection period or the time taken by the firm to realize its credit sales. Now, this indicates the time period required for collection of debts on the credit sales. So, shorter the period, the better it is, and shorter period would mean that if you, in case you have a higher ratio for debtors turnover ratio, that it will give us a shorter collection period. So, again, the debt collection period would be depending upon whether you want to compute it in terms of months, days or weeks. So, 365 or 52 days or 12 months divided by the debtors turnover ratio that you have computed.
So, for debt collection period, first of all, we have to calculate the debtors turnover ratio.
Absolutely, the debtors, because until and unless you compute the debtors turnover ratio, we cannot compute the number of days or weeks that are required to get back your cash realized from your debtors. Now, to take an illustration for the debtors turnover ratio, let us assume that the total annual credit sales are 5 lakh, the opening debtors are 80,000, the closing debtors are 1 lakh, and the number of days in a year instead of 365, they are defined as 360. So, debtors turnover ratio would mean the net.
I would like to interrupt over here. What is the basic reason of taking 360 in place of 365?
Just to make our computations more simple.
Okay, okay. There is that's no, the only.
Yeah, that is the only reason. There is no hard. Because if nothing is defined and it, the question simply says that you compute the debt collection period, in that case, the student has a choice to compute in terms of months or days
it
or
will
weeks.
Be depend upon the choice of the learner.
But in case it is specifically defined that it is to be taken only for 360 days, then of course we don't go by our own assumption.
Otherwise, there is no hard and
no
fast.
Hard and fast. It is only for the convenience of computation.
Okay. Okay. Because the number of questions it is supposed to be given, sometime it is 365, absolutely. Sometime it is 360. Yeah. The student used to get confused that whether they should take 360 or 365. So if nothing is given, it will be definitely 365, but if I specifically mention 360,
then you have to take it as 360. Hmm. So the debtors turnover ratio in this case would be the net credit sales upon the average debtors. Now it could also be possible that sometimes only the total sales as well as the sales returns are given to us, and since the numerator says that you have to compute it as net credit sales, so from the total sales you will have to deduct the sales returns.
And
to
that
get,
itself is going to become the credit sales.
Yeah. And then the average accounts receivable, since the accounts receivable to us, the bills receivable is not given to us, the opening and the closing balances are given to us. So, we compute the opening, we compute the average debtors by dividing the sum total of the opening and the closing debtors, which in our case becomes 90,000. So, the debtors turnover ratio would be the net credit sales, which is 5 lakhs divided by 90,000, and it turns out to be 5.56 times, or approximately we can say 6 times. And to compute the debt collection period, and since in the question itself it says that you have to assume the total days in the number the total days in a year to be 360, so 360 upon 5.56, it gives us 65 days approximately. So we can interpret it in this manner that the business is taking approximately 65 days to convert its debtors into cash.
Matlab, debtors used to take a credit of almost 65 days. They purchase the goods on credit from the business, and in making the payment to the business, on an average they are going to take 65 days.
Okay. So shorter would be the period. It shows that the business is better and efficiently using its resources.
Okay. Now learners, as we have came to know about the stock turnover ratio, debtors turnover ratio, now it's a time to learn something about the creditors turnover ratio. As there are the debtors, similarly there are going to be the creditors. As we know that every coin is going to have the two different sides. So, now the creditors turnover ratio, ma'am, I request you to please explain this again.
Yeah. Now, the creditors turnover ratio or accounts payable ratio also, the benefit that we are going to derive from this ratio exactly remains the same. Only thing is, in debtors turnover ratio, we were talking in terms of credit sales. Here, we will talk in terms of the credit purchases. That means the velocity or the speed with which the payments are being made to the creditors. The ratio establishes the relationship between the net credit purchases and the accounts payable. The basic objective of computing this creditors turnover ratio is to determine the efficiency in getting the benefits of the credit purchases, that how much time now the business is using to pay off its debts that it owes to the outsiders in terms of the credit purchases. The formula also is very similar to the debtors turnover ratio. So, instead of net credit sales, we have net credit purchases upon the average accounts payable, and accounts payable will include both the creditors as well as the bills payable. So, we take the average of them, and again, depending upon the information that is available, the students have to modify the formula, and there is no standard or uniform ratio for this. The lower the better.
Because it's
just the opposite of debtors turnover. So lower the better means that the business will have more time
to make the repayment of the debts. Okay. So learners, be very sure, in case of the debtors turnover ratio we have taken, the higher the ratio is going to be better. That is, that you will be able to convert your cash more easily, your debts more easily in terms of cash. On the other hand, in case of the creditors turnover ratio, we say it lower, that you are able to make the more and more benefits of the credit facilities which has been provided to you by your creditors. Be very sure that at the time of taking the net credit purchases, you have to take a total purchase minus purchase return minus cash purchases, and then you are going to get the net credit purchase. When you are going to take the average accounts payable, again you are going to be very sure and confirm about whether it's a opening creditors or a closing creditors. Opening bills payables, closing bills payable, whole or thing will be divided by 2. In case if nothing is given of this kind and only one values are given, then you are going to take only this one. If a question contains only the value of the creditors and no bills payable, then the creditor itself is going to be one value. If the bills payables are also given, take both of them. Madam, explain it with the help of some examples so that our learners may be much more clear about this concept of the creditors turnover issue.
Now, just we have the debt collection period. Here we are required to compute the debt payment period, which the payments for the credit purchases are being made to the outsiders. That means how long the business is taking to pay off its debts. So, low ratio would imply that you are taking a longer payment period. That means the business is taking more advantage of the credit purchases that it has made. Again, the process of computation remains the same depending upon whether you compute it in terms of days, months or weeks. So, the numerator is exactly the same, 12 months or 52 weeks or 365 days upon the creditor's turnover ratio. Now, to take an illustration for this, let us say that the net credit purchases are 1,50,000, the opening accounts payable are 36,000 and the closing accounts payable are 24,000. So, the average accounts payable becomes the sum total of 36,000 plus 24,000 divided by 2, which is 30,000. So, the creditor's turnover ratio would be 1,50,000, which is the net credit purchases upon 30,000. The average accounts payable, and it gives us the answer becomes 5. So, 5 times becomes the creditors turnover ratio. And if we have to compute the debt payment period or the credit payment period, so since nothing is mentioned in the illustration that you have to take the number of days in a year to be 360, so assuming 365 days as the total number of days, so 365 divided by 5, it gives us 73. The interpretation would be the business is taking 73 days in making the payments on the credit purchases that it has made.
By this time, learners, we have come to know about the stock turnover ratio, debtors turnover ratio and creditors turnover ratio. As you know that these turnover ratios can be classified into 4 different categories. So, one of the last one under this is left aside as to be the working capital turnover ratio. It would not be equitable if we are not going to take it into our discussion. So, now, it's a time for us to discuss on the topic working capital turnover ratio. Madam, please explain our learners the meaning of the working capital turnover ratio with its significance, formula, and do we have any standard is there?
Now, working capital ratio is a widely used ratio to assess the turnover ability of the firm, because working capital includes both the current assets as well as the current liability. Now, this ratio is actually indicating the number of times the unit invested in working capital produces sales. That means the efficiency with which the firm is utilizing its working capital. So, working capital means the excess of current assets over the current liability. The ratio measures the efficiency at which the working capital gets utilized by the firm. It indicates whether or not the working capital has been used effectively in making the sales or not. So, the two basic components that emerge from working capital turnover ratio is cost of sales and the average working capital. So, the formula includes the cost of sales divided by the average working capital, and by average working capital means both the opening and the closing working capital. Again, there is no standard ratio available to judge whether it is being used effectively or not, but we say higher the ratio, the better it is. More would be the ratio, the better working capital turnover the company depicts.
Here in case of the working capital, we can take both the things, sales as well as the cost of goods sold. In both the cases, suppose in a question, both the things are possible. Sales is also given, cost of goods sold is also given. You can have the formula, you can solve your question by any of the way. In both the cases, your answer is going to be correct. It won't be any problem, though the answer is going to be different. But when you are calculating the stock turnover ratio, be very careful and ensure that it is only the cost of goods sold we take into consideration. While in working capital, it's up to you, it's up to your choice whether you are going to take sales or whether you are going to take cost of goods sold. I hope I am correct in this.
Yeah, absolutely correct. Okay. Again, it will depend upon the availability of the information. Whatever is available, the student has to go accordingly. Okay. Better would be that we compute the cost of sales, but if supposing the figures are not available to compute the cost of sales, only sales is defined to us, then we go only by sales.
And then at the denominator, you are going to take the average working capital, which includes the opening working capital as well as the closing working capital divided by 2. But in most of the questions, it would not be possible for you to calculate this kind of average. Then in that case, simply take a working capital, and working capital includes the current assets minus current liabilities. So now we are going to explain these things in a much more wider detail to be in a much more simplified manner.
Working capital would mean the difference between the current assets and the current liabilities, or excess of current assets over the current liabilities. An average working capital would be the opening working capital. So you compute working capital both for the opening as well as the closing and divide it by 2, and that gives us the average working capital. Now let me take an illustration for the same. Let us suppose that the cost of sales given to us are 1,50,000, current assets are 1 lakh, current liabilities are 75,000. So, first of all, we need to define the working capital on this. So, working capital would be current assets minus current liability. So, 1 lakh minus 75,000, that is 25,000. And since the opening and the closing current assets and current liabilities are not defined to us, so we simply take whatever working capital that we have computed depending upon the illustration. Working capital turnover ratio would be the cost of sales, that is 1,50,000, divided by the working capital that we've computed, which is 25,000. It gives us an answer of 6. So that means the working capital turnover is 6 times.
6 times. Yeah. So learners, today we have tried to explain you regarding the activity ratio, in which we have taken the stock turnover ratio, debtors turnover ratio, creditors turnover ratio, and working capital turnover ratio. As you know that these are all the ratios which are somehow or the other related to the sales or cost of goods sold. So I hope that we are able to express ourselves very clearly and make you to understand the activities ratio easily. These ratios are going to help you in solving your numerical problems that are given in your self-learning material. I thank you, ma'am, for being here with us and providing such useful information. You have devoted your valuable time for providing such useful information to our learners. Thank you very much.
प्रकाशित करने राहों को आलोकित करने हम अपना दीपक स्वयं बने हम अपना रास्ता स्वयं चुने कभी पढ़े हम कहीं पढ़े वे विषय की लोच से युक्त हो मित्रों हम उठे और जाएं।